Bam!
Mr. Theroux, okay, we're going to finish our discussion about experimental designs and statistics. And with this video, we're going to go over the different experimental designs we have. We've got block design, match pairs design, and double-blind experiments. Okay, you block by a variable that you feel will have an effect on the response variable. You're taking a bit more control over the experiment, not to be confused with control group. And a control, or an experiment you think you control what you can, block what you can't control, and randomize the rest. Okay, so this sounds a lot like, and it is very, very similar to stratified random samples, only stratifying is a language or vocab word for sampling. Blocking is for experiments. So we're about to do an outline of an experiment. So you have a scenario, we'll do medical studies again. You know, men have supposedly a lot of testosterone in their system and women have a lot of estrogen. So let's just use that as an excuse for a particular medicine that we're studying that we think, okay, I can't of course control somebody's gender, and I also think that that gender, that sex is going to affect the way the chemical, the drug that I'm working with, or herb, or whatever I'm studying. I feel like there might be a possibility that that works differently between men and women. Whether that's a hunch or whether it's based on past data or experience where we've had a lot of medicines act differently for men and women, whatever that may be, you really strongly feel like this variable of gender is going to affect the results or the way that we, our response variable. And maybe cloud the issue, be a lurking variable for how it is the response is working with the explanatory variable. So if that's the case, we'll block. So let's just say that we have 500 individuals that have offered to be in a medical study, and in that medical study we feel like that, again, gender is going to make a difference in how the body responds to the drug. So within this 500, I just happen to have the same number, and it doesn't have to be the same number, but we're going to just for educational purposes in this example say that there's 250 men and 250 females. So we're going to take the 500 individuals that we have, and knowing that we believe the gender will affect the results, we have a selection or a group of 500 individuals split evenly between the two genders. Now I said here not to be confused with control group. The men are not going to act as a control group to the female. No. Both of these blocks are going to get both treatments, and you can have more than two treatments. You can have three or four or five treatments, and then just one of them being the control group. In this case, I'm going to outline, which is sort of like shorthand for a description of an experiment, this blocking design. So we have a group of individuals, there's 500. We block them into men and women. They don't have to be the same number, but in reality, the closer you can get these groups, the easier they are for comparison. At least I believe so. And then we're going to then, within each block, apply the treatment and the control. So let's say that we're going to have one group get the drug, and one group get the placebo of whatever this generic example is about. And then, again, drug, or just, you know, whatever the treatment may be, and placebo. You know, maybe we want to affect the, see the effect of taking vitamins. And so maybe someone's actually taking a vitamin and someone taking just a sugar pill, or whatever they put in placebos. And we'll mark how many people are going to be in each of these treatment groups, and for illustrative purposes, and again, and with your treatment and control group, the more even those are in size, the better. So out of these 150 people, I'm going to indicate with my outline that 125 are going to get the drug, and 125 the placebo within the group of men and women. Now the purpose of an experiment, of course, is to compare the results. So we're going to compare whatever the response variable is that we're concerned with between the treatment group and the control group. And then, of course, we did block by gender because we felt that they might possibly respond differently to whatever this treatment is to begin with. So we're not going to just compare within the men and do a comparison for the females, but we're also going to do a comparison between the gender and see if my hunch was correct. That the race of the patient, or excuse me, not the race, the sex of the patient is going to influence how they respond to the drug. So two comparisons between each block, and then finally between whatever variable it is we blocked by. Now, every experiment or sampling must have some form of randomization. Now, I have students all the time say, with an outline, by the way, all you have to do is say, I'm going to randomize. You don't have to describe how that is done, not with an outline. You will with a description of an experiment. And I've had a number of students tell me things like when they go to blocking, that they'll randomly assign the genders or the race of people or, you know, whatever, somebody's age or whatever the unit is you're working with. You can't randomize somebody's gender, so that would not make any sense. But you will randomize what treatment they get or if they get the control. And that's where the randomization would be, or how you would state the randomization in an outline. Blocking. Bam! All right. Okay. Oh, another purpose of blocking is when you create groups that are more similar, then you're taking more control, and within those groups that are more similar, where all the men are together, all the women together, if that truly affects the way the drug behaves, you'll create a test that's more sensitive. You'll minimize the variability of the results. And the same thing is true with matched pairs design. You give two treatments to two closely matched subjects or the same subject. So if I'm doing a sports test between water and Gatorade, and I want to test if that affects the recovery rates, maybe I'll put two players together that I know are the same ages, have the same, you know, based on resting heart rate, and I'm not a doctor, but have the same physical fitness, and maybe if we're doing sprints, have the same speed in whatever 50 or 100 yard dash sprint we're talking about. And then, you know, make those two exercise together, but give one the water and one the Gatorade. That would be like two closely matched subjects. Or, very often with matched pairs, though, you're doing two treatments on the same subject, or the same subject. Like, if it's a dexterity test, you have somebody do something left-handed, then right-handed. Or if it's a pre and post test, that's kind of like two treatments, where the same person will take a pre and post test, and that's like your two treatments on the same subject. Let's see, maybe you have plots of land, and those plots of land have something, and you know, they're very similar, so within each plot of land you put one of two different types of trees. There's lots of examples, and most matched pairs design experiments will be going two treatments on the same subject, but it can be two closely matched subjects. The purpose, like blocking, is to minimize as many variables as possible and isolate the effects of the treatment, making the experiment more sensitive, making it easier to determine if the treatment is actually having an effect on the response variable. You are either randomizing which of the two matched subjects get the treatment, or when you have the same unit or subject getting both treatments, you need to randomize which of the two treatments come first. So in a dexterity test, if you're having somebody do something left-handed than right-handed, well, I'm right-handed, so most things I do better with my right hand. But even if you have me do a test with my left hand first, I will learn something about what it takes to get that job done, which might make my right hand work even faster. So, excuse me. So when you do that experiment, you know, you would randomize, okay, half the subjects by a coin flip or random selection or names out of a hat, but half the subjects or units will do something with their left hand first, and the other half would do the dexterity test with their right hand first. That kind of idea, where you are randomizing which treatment they get done first. In your textbook, a lot of matched pairs design questions, these tend to be at the end of the chapters, like when we get to studying one sample mean Z and T tests. You don't know what that means yet. but these match pairs design questions will show up at the end of those sections, and they'll look like they're two samples where there's a column of numbers, two columns of numbers. Well, because we're dealing with those in pairs, we'll actually be working with a column of differences, and you only analyze the difference between those two measurements, like a pre and post test, like a speed of doing something with your left hand minus the speed of something done with the right hand. So these match pairs designed in the textbooks tend to look like they might possibly be two sample tests, but indeed we are only working with the differences between those matched values, so it is a one variable test. That doesn't mean much right now though in our textbook, so I'll just mention later on that I have talked about that briefly back when we were doing the chapter about creating or designing experiments. So match pairs design, last type. Okay. All right, double-blind experiment. Neither the subject nor the administrator knows who is getting what treatment. You use generic labels for the treatment and let the third party administer that experiment. They return the results and you examine the results. Now, you as the designer of the experiment, of course, knows, how do you even do double-blind experiments? Medical study. You design an experiment, you want to test, some kind of heart medicine maybe. That's a critical type setting. You don't want to give anybody just a sugar pill when they have a life-threatening illness, but there are these two drugs that both treat the same illness. Well, the doctors will just know that here's drug A and here's drug B. They won't actually know what treatment they're giving to the patient. So maybe, they won't be inclined to give the newer, possibly better drug to the worst patients. Well, that's okay because both drugs will treat whatever that illness is. You're just going to study if one drug does a better job. So, you'll send those drugs out, they'll be labeled A and B, the doctors won't supposedly know what they're administering, the patients won't know what drug they're receiving, and then at the end, whatever the health response is, and the results will come back to you, and they'll say, okay, for drug A, we got this response, for drug B, we got this response, and then you as a statistician will know what treatment A was, what treatment B was, determine the probability of the observed difference and see if it's statistically significant to decide whether the new drug was better or not. As long as you've designed a test, made generic labels, and then sent them out to a third party to actually run the experiment, it's not a big deal to run a double-blind experiment, and their purpose is to help eliminate bias. If it's a health study, the doctors won't be inclined to give a new medicine to the worst patients. If you're just testing waterproofing on shoes, maybe you won't use them differently because you know you got the new treatment, not the old treatment. And then finally, experiments must have realism so that the results can be generalized into the real world. And that's my end of discussion about experiments and being able to create good data that we then can analyze later with our statistical techniques. I'm Mr. True. Thank you for watching. Read your book. Really important to read your examples in this chapter, and go do your homework.